Good afternoon, all. Thank you for continuing to follow us on our second day of Soft Solidarity Assembly, New Alliances, New Solidarities. We opened the day with a very powerful and productive conversation with the initiatives in Wedding, moderated by my co-curator Katrin Pohlmann and Kerry Hempel. And right now we are continuing our session with our two keynotes, two thinkers actually whose thoughts on solidarity and resistance were very formative for us while we were discussing about the assembly. These are Eva Majewska and Yasin El-Hajsaleh. Collective building is one of the hardest self-reflective exercises or tasks for humans, as proved by history, as it is also constantly intervened by systems of sovereignty. And as Eva Majewska regularly refers to Benjamin's thesis, we are actually like all expected on Earth, and we are all coming endowed with a weak messianic power, a power that past has a claim, and that claim cannot be settled very cheaply. Of course, using the term new in the new solidarities, new alliances, we are very aware of the loadedness of the term new, because as it is always like used alongside with destruction in our capitalist modernity as an excuse to destroy, to extract, to take over. But of course, when we call new here, we would like to connect to existing wisdom and survival strategies that can be translated to our current needs, because we know that there are a lot of empty parts of the road that we are taking, which is very beautifully said by Chicana thinker, feminist, Gloria Anzaldúa, when she says, "Voyager, there are no bridges, one builds them as one walks." And this is the exercise that we are trying to do here in our Soft Solidarity Assembly. I'm very honored to be hosting today Eva Majewska, one of the most influential feminist philosophers in Europe, and someone whose conversation is always also influential in my thinking, in the way I think about the world. If I may make a small introduction before she starts her statement, weak resistance as soft solidarity. This is something that we also discussed before, that weak resistance is closely connected to the idea of soft solidarity as a feminist also methodology. I would like to make... I would like to make a short introduction among my pages. Eva studied philosophy, French literature and gender studies at the University of Warsaw, and after her PhD she was a visiting scholar at the University of California, Berkeley, working on theories of subjectivity and translation, and she has taught in Jagiellonian University of Krakow, Institute of Human Sciences in Vienna, and University of Warsaw. She was also a fellow at Berlin's ICI, and she contributed to many important texts about the feminist movement's position in the fight against the fascisms of today. I think I should leave the word to Eva for taking the stage further. Eva, we are very happy to have you here. Thank you for making time for us, and I'm looking forward to our conversation.
Thank you so very much. I hope you can hear me. Well, thank you so much for the invitation to this amazing assembly, of which the main topic, solidarity, is a topic of my life, actually. As I grew up in Gdańsk, where the Solidarność movement began when I was 2 years old, I have the experience of actually visiting the shipyard of Gdańsk already when I was 2 years old. And since then, I've been sort of participating in the making of solidarity as a child of parents who were quite politically involved. So since then, obviously, it was quite possible that I would be interested in political philosophy and political theory. And here I am now theorizing solidarity, on one hand, working on the historical Solidarność movement, which started in 1980 in Poland, but also wider investigating feminist analysis of solidarity, feminist practice of solidarity. And so when Ovo, you told me that you are preparing an event on soft solidarities, I felt, of course, a sort of affiliation, a sort of sisterly connection to this idea, because working on solidarity, on counterpublics of the subaltern, of women, of the excluded, but also working on weak resistance, makes me quite keen on the idea of soft solidarity. So in what I prepared for today, I will go through mainly the weak resistance idea and project, but then I will try to connect it somehow to see how this idea of softness can be not only connected with what I work on, but also how it can be found there already. So I think that a good starting point would be to say something about the archive and the necessity of revisiting the archive. As you might remember from Jacques Derrida's text on the archive fever, he speaks there of the visits into the past in the archive as a work for the future. And I very much like this point. I think that there is practically no visit in the archive where we wouldn't be working for the future. And as Derrida is arguing, every visit in the archive is actually a visit where the archive, actually of the weakness of the archivist. So basically, my own visits and investigations within the archives were always an effort to avoid data. The example of the Polish National Archive in this context of the secret police is a very good example, because there, in some topics, if you demand the information, if you demand to visit the archive, you receive extremely chaotic data. You really have to focus very much, and you really have to be very stubborn to make any sense of the diversified, scattered, chaotic data that comes also from different instances, different institutions, etc. So basically, the encounters within the archive. The other one is that you encounter also the multiplicity of the past strategy, of research, of methodology, basically. So this is particularly important if you try to build solidarity today, and you know that this is 21st century, that effort of methodology, basically. So this is particularly important if you try to build solidarity today, and you know that this is 21st century, that efforts of building solidarity have been made already in the past, encounter the whole diversity of what has already been done. You might feel overwhelmed and somehow petrified by the amount of the material and the possible amount of mistakes that you can make. You might also feel that, you said that the notion of new is quite controversial. Yes, it is. Also because as social activists and as social theorists, we are obviously tempted to invent something new. And this whole neoliberal propaganda of launching a new strategy, a new entity every time is threatening, not only to us as embodied human beings, which cannot create something new every second, which have to repeat. Also, in order to rehearse our strategies, we have to repeat them you know, stage them and restage them over and over again in order to finally perhaps come up with a good version of Solidarity or a good version of a lecture, even of an art piece, etc. So within this neoliberal times, when we are driven to work in rather in projects than in long-term entities, and therefore we are forced to reinvent ourselves and our activity over and over again, there is a risk of being petrified and therefore being demobilized by this threat of novelty. We might feel, okay, there is nothing new I'm going to say now, and therefore should be stopped. Well, I would obviously argue that no, but still, this is a threat. Another problem when we encounter the archives, and especially the archives of social agency, of solidarity building, etc., and this is quite, I would say, this is quite a new threat, is basically all kinds of controversies surrounding the agents, the activists, the participants of the social movements which inspire us. This is particularly tangible in Poland right now, when within the women's strike we have different leaders, campaigns and information spread about how they did something wrong to somebody, how they misbehaved there and there, how they acted not on the premises of feminism but on some other premises, etc., etc. And I believe, without taking a stand in with these accusations, I believe that this is something that happens all everywhere. And there is obviously a whole policing work involved in this kind of stories, but there is also sometimes stories of genuinely amazing people, people who inspired thousands or millions, who still are either engaged in politics that we wouldn't subscribe to, or basically who commit acts which are very complicated. And then this can discourage us from following the political idea, the struggles, the strategies might be amazingly inspiring. So that's also a threat. When we visit the archive, we might learn about the leaders of the social movements and political movements that inspire us, facts that might make us want to disappear, basically, to never try to do any social agency again. And I think this is a terrible risk, but also this is a risk that we have to face, and a risk where we have to, I think, be, I'm sorry for the more, but we have to be modern in a sense that we have to have the ability to decide for ourselves what is important at this particular point and to what extent one person's wrongdoing can cancel or dismantle the entire social mobilization, which might at this particular moment be very important and very inspiring for us. So this is also a risk of archive that Derrida is not speaking about very much, but this is something that I believe we discovered today. We are also working with the archive and with the past, which, as I said, after Derrida is a work for the future. We are also confronting the authority of the archive in a sense that Howard Zinn gives to the world. So he speaks about the gatekeepers. There are all kinds of persons and strategies involved in preserving the status quo, basically. So in Howard Zinn's theory of the archive, which I think is very important for any practice of solidarity that we want to do today, we have to understand that, for instance, whatever has been ever documented or archivized is actually fitting in certain categories of what it means at this particular epoch to be comprehensible, understandable, representative, etc., etc. Howard Zinn makes a fantastic series of criticisms of the archive, and one of those criticisms, which is particularly important for our topic of solidarity, is a critique of the archives as being typically filled with narratives of unique individual persons, not of groups. This is very important because if a movement, at the other globalist movement, at the, I don't know, communist movements of the 19th century, if we look at the anarchist movement of Spain of 1930s, any social mobilization whatsoever, it's obviously the multiplicity of voices that makes it particular. Not only the voices of the most audible leaders of the movement. So therefore, the account of a social movement based solely on several chosen persona is a very different account from the one which we gather if we try to collect not only many voices, which is one strategy, but also trying to record and document and archivize the multiplicity of voices, the situations where multiple heterogeneous voice is being heard from a social movement. This would also change very much our understanding of history and our understanding of the social movements and our understanding of the archive. There are also multiple strategies of silencing the, as Howard Zinn says, the non-conforming agents and groups. So therefore, whoever gets into the archive has to be a more or less literate person, for instance. The archives are filled with written documents. However, they do not so much contain the spoken word documents. So therefore, all those groups were the most important, very interesting warning coming from a very unexpected side. I think you would never suspect me speaking about this person in this context. So this site I want to quote right now is basically Gayatri Spivak and her text on the politics of translation. Mm-hmm. In the text, she speaks about the solidarity between women in different countries, not as built on similarities. So she says it very openly, that the strategy of a translator, which would consist in the statement, she is just like me. So me, the translator, I would say about somebody living in a very different country, in a very different culture, that she is just like me. This is precisely, according to Gayatri Spivak, this is precisely the biggest mistake we can do. My obligation as somebody who wants to practice the feminist solidarity, solidarity between women, and more generally solidarity for everyone, not just women actually, would be to learn, as Gayatri Spivak says, to learn the language of the other. That is the principal thing we should do. And here we see the weakness already at the starting point. Because if I say that my solidarity is based on the practice of learning the language of other, what it means? It means that I don't know something. It means that I have to learn something, in this case, a new language, right? It means that I have not enough of knowledge of perception of linguistic skills, and I have to work to get it better. I have to learn the word of others. So I believe that this is the perhaps not the first, because I think this in this encounter with the archive, we already encounter a weakness, but this is the second stage sort of weakness that we discover when we want to practice solidarity, that we have to resign from this very easy assumption that the other might be just like us. And we have to say, okay, I'm going to learn your language first. And then I'll see what extent our similarities go. Solidarity then seems to be, I mean, if translation and if archive visits, critical archive visits, I would say, are informative for the solidarity practice, I would say that solidarity is a transversal practice. And this is something I borrow from Félix Guattari and from his book, The Three Ecologies, where he speaks about the social change as something that goes, that cuts through very different sectors of society. That the acts of social change cannot be only situated in one context. For instance, solely in institutions, or solely in grassroots groups, or solely in schools, solely here, there, no. If a social change is supposed to happen, it cuts through the entire society, through every layer of it. I believe that this heterogeneous vision of social change is very important for our understanding of solidarity. So it's not only that we have to learn the languages of others, but we have to also accept that perhaps in the contexts which are very distant from our own, in my case, I believe institutional slash militarized context would be very distant. This is not something I'm really practicing very much these days or ever in my life, to be honest. So I must learn that, for instance, if there are some changes in those sectors which I never visit and which I'm genuinely opposed to in many ways, perhaps this is not against me. And this is something that also Nancy Fraser speaks of, where she writes about the counterpublics of feminist of different organizations, of different scale, of different content, of different strategy, and then each of them is still defending the women's rights. So therefore, this feminist counterpublics is composed of series of different movements, and sometimes contradictory ones. That's important, right? That, for instance, if we look at the feminist movement, we can say that there are some parts of it which are absolutely against pornography to an extent of forbidding it. But there is also a wing within feminism which would defend pornography as, if revisited, if revised, if not patriarchal, perhaps emancipatory for women, right? So altogether, within feminism, we see in some topics, in some cases, conflicted strategies, opposing strategies, perhaps also excluding each other, right? But still, all this movement that we call the feminist movement contains it all, so also contains contradictions. So therefore, this idea that our vision of solidarity can be without contradictions, I think this idea we can forget about, basically, if we embrace the kind of weak solidarity, weak resistance strategy. Okay, speaking of different kinds of institutions and different kinds of contexts, I would like to also remind of Michael Hart and Tony Negri and their book, The Assembly, where they present all kinds of social movements as practicing what I would call soft solidarity very often. And in that book, they make this amazing point about discussions concerning reform and revolution, which is also a very debated, very strongly debated strategic topic, which really, I would say, torpedoes solidarity very often within social movement. And then they make this amazing point, saying that we have to perhaps reinvent the idea of reform and the idea of revolution to properly conflict them. Because if we borrow those concepts, their understandings from 19th century, we will be speaking about a reality which does not exist anymore. So we will not address the actual social movement, but our images of it belonging in the 19th century, where the notion of reform and revolution in their conflict have been coined. And I think this is a good point to address, and it also associates with the idea of transversality, in a sense that perhaps our understanding of certain formats of social agency as ones which cannot go together have to be revisited as we witness social move of certain formats of social agency elements which perfectly contain, like feminism, which perfectly contain contradictory tendencies and still manage to go on. When I was building this idea of the weak resistance, I was also looking at the Eastern European theory and trying to figure out how I can reference authors that I know, that I grew up with, and that are mainly belonging to liberal tradition, and yet which could be interesting and useful in a feminist, socialist feminist perspective. And there is one author that I could recommend very gladly, which is Václav Havel, whom you might know as a theater writer and the president of the Czech Republic after 1989. So Václav Havel, who is basically not only affiliated with liberal tradition, but who was also later blamed for the introduction of neoliberal economy in Czech Republic, which cannot be doubted. So I don't contest that statement, and I think he was responsible in many ways for all kinds of neoliberal changes that happened in the Czech Republic. But what I want from him is not his involvement in neoliberal Czech Republic, but what I want from him is a reference to a text that he wrote in 1978, so much earlier than that, in which he discusses the possibilities of being political and being resistant while we feel weak and powerless. So this essay is called The Power of the Powerless, and I absolutely recommend it to anyone because it's an amazing take, I think, on how those of us who feel disempowered and alienated from others, detached from others, in a confrontation with a huge political entities, like in the case of Havel in 78, it was basically the Cold War and the huge empires kind of staying in a Cold War positions, which basically in the mid 70s, everybody thought it's going to stay like this forever. It was an overwhelming feeling that history has been maybe not over, but has been established in this particular form. And therefore, any agency we can do will not result in anything tangible. And so therefore, this was a very demobilizing situation for all kinds of people who were critical of the existing reality, who wanted to have a more democratic, more egalitarian society, and yet could not mobilize because of this sense of powerlessness. So Havel makes this amazing point that those everyday, ordinary acts of resistance actually count as political. That even the very weak forms of agency can and should be seen as political. And perhaps one day, he makes this point in the end of the essay, perhaps one day we will see them together. So interestingly enough, his essay was translated into Polish very quickly, and already in 1979 was smuggled in Poland and read by some people. 1 year later, in 1980, was building Solidarity movement, Solidarność movement. So the huge, workers' initiative of an independent labor union that gathered 10 million of Polish people by March of 81 to not only resist the existing government, but also to construct alternative structures, kind of workers' councils, all kinds of democratic institutions, to democratize the society. So I believe that for Havel, who was genuinely liberal already in 1970s, it must have been a huge surprise that he wrote something from this perspective of this alienated, separated individual. And suddenly, 1 year later, 2 years later, he saw masses of people, millions of people, as I said, 10 million. It's a lot of people. It's many people, sorry. He saw those masses of people uniting, and some of them were referencing his text as inspiration. So this power of powerless in the case of Havel was basically an observation that even very ordinary acts, even extremely powerless gestures can build up. And together in a huge mass, they will mean something eventually. So later in 1980s, James Scott obviously makes his summary of a huge research he did in Southeast Asia, where he was following peasants, basically doing demonstrations which consisted in marching. But if millions of people march throughout the country, obviously it has some impact and it has some results. And later in the 2000s, I was observing and analyzing the feminist movement in Poland some 4 years ago. And what I discovered was that also this kind of very ordinary activities consisting in, for instance, sharing pictures, selfie pictures on some websites, joining online groups, wearing black clothes as a symbol of support for the women's rights. These very ordinary and very accessible forms of agency were sufficient for many women to later join the strike actions, street protests, and all kinds of demonstrations and political power, which basically was a kind of prelude, a prolegomena for today's women's strike, which we have in Poland still, and which right now tries also to develop certain forms of negotiating strategies, of demands, of councils, and which tries to propose an alternative to the existing government, but which last week and 2 weeks ago consisted in some 500,000 people marching in demonstrations, blocking the streets of Warsaw and 500 other cities and towns in Poland, and basically doing a huge revolutionary situation. So speaking of the women's movement, I have to mention, obviously, that there is something about the sort of feminine socialization which does not really enter the accounts of political agency. For instance, if we imagine anti-fascist agency, we very often tend to imagine a young man in the Antifa fighting bravely with the police or with some fascists or whoever. This is an image which we have and which is a legitimate one. Obviously, there are people who are anti-fascists and who present themselves in such form. But there are also those people who like Danuta Danielsson, whom you might remember from this beautiful black and white pictures from Sweden where she hits a head of a neo-Nazi with her handbag. So I'm sorry not to share the image, but you might have seen it. It's a quite angry elderly lady in her 60s, you know, using a very ordinary tool, handbag, to hit a head of the neo-Nazi young man. So this kind of image, for instance, is not really usually archivized as the typical anti-fascist. While if we look at all kinds of women who are educating young people especially, they would probably have this kind of, you know, this kind of vigor, this kind of anger, but also this kind of care for the world, of themselves, but also of others. And, you know, they would insist on having the world shared by people rather than being sort of combated by some Ubermensch or whoever there would be. So to close it down, because I see that the time is passing.
Yes.
I also noticed that. So do I have still 5 minutes or should
yes,
I?
Yes, you have 5 minutes, yeah.
Nice. So coming to the softness, that's a notion that never occurs in the political philosophy. We have to understand that. Softness is nothing similar to whatever I have seen in political theory books. What I have seen there is heroism, is victimhood, is messianism, is all kinds of bravery, you know, audacity. Even Antigone, who is perceived as a representative of the feminine in the political sphere, it's like that by Hegel, but it's in Sophocles' tragedy. It's in half of feminists are basically also repeating the same strategy of reading. There is an interesting author, Bonnie Honig, who speaks of Antigone as somebody who would never exist and would never succeed without her sister Ismene. So if we look at Antigone and her tragedy, we should, according to Honig, see the two sisters bound by an anti-patriarchal sororal pact. So therefore Ismene, who is basically the kind of accepting, sort of powerless, caring person, she, in her connection to Antigone, makes it possible that Antigone can follow the steps of her strategy. But also, if we look at Ismene, we see that Antigone also has this kind of humane, empathetic, caring face. So therefore, the ways she addresses Ismene and her brother and other people of her family sometimes has this kind of humane aspects as well. So therefore, the softness I would see in care, especially. So basically, if we say soft solidarity, I'm thinking immediately of care, but also I think of maintenance and making sure that the human, as individual, but also as species, survives till the next day. So basically all kinds of maintenance labor, sometimes annoying, but also sometimes requiring some skill, and therefore soft, is there. In the softness, I see also the tendency to accept our vulnerability, to accept our risk that we will be harmed, because we will, regardless whether we want to make a super heroic version of political agency or whether we want to make the agency of the weak and try to practice our weakness as a form of resistance, as a form of political agency, we might still be harmed. And therefore this acceptance for the vulnerability, this acceptance for the fact that yes, we are vulnerable, and therefore our political agency should be based on embracing this weakness, and therefore also on building structures which allows this weakness not to kill us, but also not to be completely forgotten. Mm. Because it is this weakness, this acknowledgement that here I don't win, here I'm losing, right? Here I'm vulnerable. And therefore perhaps I want to demand something from the authorities, from the government, from the people in power, from my own comrades in my own movement. Sometimes this is also what happens. So therefore, the softness consists also not only in emphasizing the importance of the weakness, but also in the ability of making those weak points, those weak strategies, of making them acting politically, of making their agency not only existing, but also visible. So basically, the soft solidarity, I would say, would consist in embracing our vulnerability. And that would be it from me. So thank you very much for having me there, and also for hearing this a bit chaotic presentation. And I'm very happy to discuss it and listen also to the other speakers today. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Eva, thank you so much, because what you call chaotic actually like kind of gave us like the whole theoretical frame that we have been working inside and outside, and it really gave us as a big horizon to look towards to, also from the past to present. So thank you very much. I would love actually for you and Yasin also to discuss together at the end, but maybe I would have maybe one question, just like kind of to maybe bridge. I would love to ask actually about like how you see the mutation of the political subjectivity today. You know, in the face of the kind of fascisms that we are faced with, as you're also saying in your various texts, not coming from the state, but also coming from, you know, different communities, like the micro-fascisms. And is there, because you have been so much also talking about the archive and the and its power and its dysfunction, also in our understanding of the history of the political subject, how do you see the components of the political subject of today in order, you know, to transgress the chaos that we are faced with right now, also fired by new models of fascism?
Thank you for this question, and thank you so much for this beautiful kind of embracing of my talk. It's always very nice after a talk to hear this kind of affirmative statement. So I'm happy that if I can contribute anyhow to the theoretical sort of lines. I mean, I would say on one hand that we have to get back to certain ideas of modernity. We have to. I would say that we really have to try to build up strategies that are perceived as long-term strategies. And this is a very modern concept, which after the postmodern revolution, not only in theory, in philosophy, but also in management, in business, in governance, etc. So after this break up with long-term strategies, I think we need to reclaim them again. So as autonomous social movements, even in our being dispersed and heterogeneous, and even if for the tasks that we are facing, this heterogeneity and fragmentation is necessary. Mm-hmm. I think having an idea of a common, of being here together, is a very important one. And this is why I very much like Extinction Rebellion, this whole ecological movement to stop the environmental catastrophe. This is why I like it so much, because when Greta Thunberg and other activists are speaking, they are speaking of a responsibility that we have for the whole Earth. We, meaning the whole species.
Yes.
So she doesn't go into the details. I mean, okay, she has those funny little quarrels with Donald Trump, but it's actually him who starts them, right, usually. So if he makes some jokes about him, it's not really putting him away outside from this from this responsibility. It's rather sort of responding to his very bad jokes. But otherwise than that, I don't see her excluding anybody. I see her as somebody who has this idea that we all can contribute to the embetterment of the world situation in the context of climate. And so therefore, in context of fascism, I would see a similar thing. And this idea of transversality is a helpful tool to comprehend that perhaps we do not have to all agree on everything. But trying to imagine, trying to be in this together, trying to imagine that we are all here to stop fascism or to not to let it rule again. I mean, I live in Warsaw. Warsaw is like a huge grave of a fascist regime, actually. It's a city which in 75% has been destroyed. And I'm talking now only about architecture, because what I'm going to say next is going to be much more touching and much more emotional, which is that also some millions of people have lost their lives on the streets of the city. Yeah. So while there are entire districts that have been smashed as a fascist response, for instance, to the Warsaw uprising, to the uprising in the Warsaw Jewish ghetto, etc., etc. So when you walk in there, you can sense still a sort of ghostly presence of the people who have been there, yes, and who have been resisting in all ways possible. So resisting with armed, uprising, resisting in persisting this whole situation, surviving it, resisting by not signing up to the fascist agenda, resisting by making it difficult for the fascist occupants to be here, etc., etc. And so here in Warsaw, and I think this politics of location is important, I believe that I cannot speak for every form of fascism. You know, I don't know very well the Brazilian version of fascism or the American version of fascism or even the German, today's German versions of microfascisms might escape me. But what I know is what I see here and it's basically a form of most absurd and ignorant and idiotic fascism that you can see. In the March for Independence 2 days ago, an apartment was burned because some neo-Nazi idiot threw a petard in somebody's flat through the window because they disagreed with a rainbow flag which was hanging two balconies above this place. So he put on fire another apartment. By mistake, probably. But anyways, it was an aggressive action. And so when you see this kind of actions, you might think about with whom I want to defend this apartment. There are so many people who criticized this act of violence, idiotic, aggressive violence, with whom I disagree on all kinds of levels. And yet still, if we stand against fascism, I believe we have to find ways. We have to find ways to stand against fascism together. So these ways of building togetherness cannot obviously mean that we consecrate our, I don't know, queer feminist anti-capitalist agenda, which would be more or less my description, right? Mm-hmm. I don't want to give up that. But then on the other hand, I don't want to stop the possible success of stopping fascism by refusing to contact anybody who differs from my political perspective, from me. That would be, I think we were trying to practice this kind of politics for many years now, and it simply didn't succeed. Yes. So what I'm trying to say is that perhaps there are different alliances to be made for different tasks and purposes, and they might be very diversified, they might be contradictory, but if they are built from a perspective of a long-term goal, which is basically not to have fascists dominating the streets of Warsaw in the next few years, then I believe that we need to try to build up coalitions which will not evaporate. People like myself, so who are basically not trying to resign from queer identity and from feminist identity, but also I think thinking of how far possibly we can build the agendas, and to what extent and to what purposes do we have to keep those coalitions forever? Or perhaps can we have, you know, more spontaneous or more strategically planned coalitions specifically dedicated to certain tasks? This is, I believe, what we need. And I believe there is a sense of modern kind of long-term rational planning behind it. And I believe also there is a sense of community or universality that is also a part of this agenda. So a recognition that actually all in all, as humans, we demand the same respect. This idea of universality somehow enlightens the effort, the work, the labor that is necessary to contribute to build this kind of longer terms, strategies, alliances, etc. I'm not sure if I answered really to your question, but I was trying as much as I could. And thank you for it, obviously.
Yes, I think it really gave us, again, another good frame. And I would maybe would continue the conversation afterwards, after Yasin, and I would maybe go a little bit also further on the idea of the universality in this way. I think this is a very important also discussion that is raised by many different contemporary thinkers at the moment. So, but for the moment, I would love to thank you for this rich session that I think nourished our souls and our bodies and minds at the same time. Hope to meet you here again with Yasin for even though short for a together conversation after his session. So thank you so much, Eva, one more time. Thank you.